So it was not planned, but since Monday, I got several questions about the outcome of my build farm that I presented last year. It was still a prototype, so I figured that maybe it could make sense to provide a quick update. So it was last year. It's what it looks like according to Frank, our artist over there. In practice, it's slightly less broken. It looks more like this. It used to look more like this. So it was made on low-end HDMI sticks using some Rockchip RK3288 CPUs, which are pretty powerful. But the device were absolutely crappy. Some solders were not properly made. So it was not very reliable. The power supply was a disaster on these devices. There were some heating issues. Sometimes they were very hot. And if we look on the photo, they were tightly packed and there was no place for airflow. It used to boot from a micro SD, which is not very fun when you have to manipulate the device once in a while because you end up with an SD card in the hand, so you realize you've just lost one node. So at least it was a prototype. However, the CPU is really powerful. I wanted to try again with the same CPU. It's so powerful that it works well even for small projects like HAProxy, which contains, I counted this morning, around 80 files to build, which is not much, but in fact, if you have many very small CPUs, it's not possible to save time when you have too few files to build. So I contemplated other options. I talked about the Mickey board, which is here in photo. I did not have one by then because they were out of stock, but I managed to get some. In fact, my company offered me a few of them, so it was nice. There is a dual memory channel on this one, DDR3 1600. It's really fast, and the build time depends mostly on the RAM performance, so that counts a lot. So after assembling them, as you can observe, there were still some remaining issues to solve. So yes, I used to pack them together using some foam. It was not really practical to attach a heatsink. If you look, you have the CPU here. So if you put a big heatsink, you have nothing to, no hole, for example, to attach it. It's not really convenient, but anyway, it's better than most alternatives I have seen to date. Some huge power losses in a micro USB connector. I managed to jump as high as 4 amps during overclocking. Basically, it does not stand it anymore because the voltage is too low at the input of the regulator. And another problem, as you can see, it uses a lot of switch ports, so I did not have any room anymore on my desk to plug anything else. But at least it worked. So I tried to improve this stuff by using some plastic spacers, 22 millimeters M3. There were a few design issues on the boards. Some resistors were too close to the holes, so they disappeared while screwing them. Fortunately, they were used only for the Ethernet LED, so it was not a big deal. I could repair a few of them. Fixing the heatsink was another challenge. I used some thermal tape from 3M. It's hard to find some good ones. I learned during tests and using various reports on the net that the most important thing is to find the thinnest ones. So this one was quite efficient, but not as much as having some thermal paste and some screws. In order to address the power losses, I attacked the problem at the root cause. So the micro USB is not used anymore, as you can see. Fortunately, there was a big capacitor at the entry, so it helped for the solder. It was required to use thick cables as well, by the way. And for the switch ports, I figured that I had a ClearFog board, which was offered to me a few years ago. I used it at the beginning for various testing, and I used it less and less, and I realized that it was a nice option to use as a switch, and probably as another build node as well. In fact, it was not very fast as a build node, not interesting. It's just a dual Cortex-A9 at high frequency, but not interesting for builds. But it gave me some ideas. Regarding this CC, in fact, when you have many cores, you need to parallelize the stuff a lot to keep the network busy and the CPUs busy, to keep everything busy. Otherwise, when you build small files, you spend as much time uploading the sources as to build them, and you end up with idle time everywhere. So I managed to saturate all the 24 cores of the farm I built at home using 6 boards, using between 60 and 100 processes. So that requires a huge amount of RAM on the, well, in fact, it depends for whom, only a few gigs, in fact, just to build this way. I needed also to update to latest Git for this TC because I did not have the choice of what to do with the local processes. Either I could use some local processes to run the build or to do nothing. And the latest Git provided some options to have a different limit for the number of local pre-processing jobs on the build node. And I found this very interesting because it allowed me to have a huge amount of pre-processing on the local node to queue some tasks to then submit to the build node. I enabled L0 compression. Initially, I did not believe in it because I considered it would waste some CPU, but in fact, no, L0 is really cheap and it managed to divide by 4 to 5 approximately the pre-processed code that is uploaded, and pre-processed code is huge. There are spaces everywhere and empty lines, etc. So in fact, it's a nice saver. Otherwise, you waste time just uploading the files. I discovered by just by luck that there was a hard-coded limit of 50 parallel jobs in this CC. I think it's recent, probably, because it has been used for a much larger build. I discovered this because whatever the number of processes I used for the build, there was idle time everywhere, on my local PC and on the build nodes. So there was something strange, and the network was not saturated at all. And when looking at the code, I found that DCC uses log files to know which build node is available. And there is a loop with only 50 iterations to find the spare node. So I raised it to 500 just to have some margin. And something fun as well, it stopped working. I don't remember which kernel, maybe 4.8 or 4.9, something like this. Because a new option was added in the C flags in the kernel, dash WA something, I don't remember which one. And it happens that this TC considers that all these flags are for the assembler, so they must not be submitted to a remote node, so everything was built locally. So it took me quite some time to find this, and finally I could patch it by making an exception for this specific option. So yeah, well, it's not really huge. Here is the command line I'm using. In fact, it's in the script. I'm not typing that all the time. Certain things like some timers to check for an available node. In fact, this CC uses completely separate processes. None of them communicates with the other ones. So when you start a new process and it wants an available node, if it does not find one, in fact, it just polls, and when I'm saying polls, it regularly polls the log directory to see if a node is available. And the initial timer number was something like 1 second or something like this, which was not not convenient for small files like this. So I'm polling much faster now. I noticed that the load was really uneven between the nodes. Sometimes some nodes were saturated, other nodes were not used at all. That's understandable due to the way the load is distributed. So that still caused a significant amount of idle time. What else? Sometimes the local machine is heavily loaded due to the high number of local processes needed to try to fill these empty slots. And I also noticed that sometimes I lost a node because I tried at various settings. I overclocked the RAM, the CPU, everything just to test, because after all, that's the purpose of the experiment. And when you lose a node, it stops the build for quite some time so that you reach a timeout and the node is marked dead. So all this made me think that I should improve the process. And fortunately, I had some room on the clear fog to place a process I happen to know well. So I installed HAProxy. I considered this option during the last presentation, but I did not try. So this time I tried. I used the LeastCon algorithm, which consists in using the least possible number of connections on each server. This one was very interesting because, in fact, you still have limited memory bandwidth on each CPU, and placing the least possible number of processes on each CPU ensures you have a maximum amount of memory bandwidth available per build process. So it improves the situation quite a bit. I also limited the number of concurrent connections on each CPU to the number of available cores. That's something nice as well because it limits the amount of cache thrashing. It also allows me to set up huge buffers on HAProxy so that my local PC uploads the pre-processed files which remain in HAProxy buffers, and as soon as the build node finishes and sends back the result, immediately a new job can be sent, so there is almost no time wasted uploading files on a shared link, for example. And what else? And I figured that after this, I could reduce the number of build processes to keep the build farm busy. And I discovered some idle time on my PC, so I figured it was nice to use these CPUs for a build as well. And in the end, I managed to save between 15 and 20% time, which is quite nice, after all, by adding just a small machine and a process. Less idle, less contention. To give you an idea, just to build the latest 3.10 kernel, I build all the modules when I do this. On my local machine, which is reasonably beefy, I would say, it takes 13 minutes, and when adding just a 6 board, it goes down to 4 minutes and 3.5. So it's quite nice. I measured on the stats page of HAProxy, I measured a peak to 120 files built per second, which is really nice. I tried to put HAProxy on the local machine to avoid depending on an additional machine and just rely on a cheap switch, but it's not as much interesting because GCC and HAProxy fight for the CPU, adding latency, so I have to remove some GCC processes to leave some room for HAProxy, so I lose some local power, so it's not that much interesting in the end. It happened to me a few times to kill HAProxy by accident because during my daily job of developing HAProxy, I probably run a kilo HAProxy 200 times a day, and sometimes it ends up on the wrong process or just a copy-paste after PS. And I discovered this nice little device, which is EdgeRouter X. It's sold as a router, but probably they got it wrong, because in fact it can do many other things. It runs on a MediaTek chip with an integrated gigabit switch on 5 ports. It has enough RAM and flash to install some extra software. It's run a variant of Linux, which is in fact Viata, but and some out-of-tree kernel. But I didn't care. I noticed that it used to work. Initially, it was not stable. It crashed a lot of time, but I updated the firmware and it was fine. So I placed a HAProxy on this one. It worked pretty fine. It consumes only 4 watts, so I could even power it from a USB port from one of the Mickey boards. It's a bit dirty, but save one USB port. And the HAProxy on this device managed to achieve around half a gigabit of traffic, which is quite nice for a $50 device. So here is what it looks like without the cables. So the power supply on the left, 4 boards only, because there are 5 ports on the switch or router or whatever you want to call it. The 5 ports below, one of them used as an uplink, and the other ones used for each for a board. A photo from above. It was before soldering the wires, as you can see. And I discovered new issues. Since the board started to become quite efficient and powerful, the power supply did not stand the peak power anymore. It was advertised as 50 watts, but it's not exactly true. There were still some voltage drops, but I patched it. In fact, it's just plastic, so you have to put some strength on it, and it finishes by opening. So inside, it looks like this. And you can observe the culprit here, the resistor, which is here to measure the current. So you lose 100 millivolts in this one, and it tells the transistor in front that you should stop pulling power out of it. So you just install another one on top of it, and it's wrong by 50%, and that's fine. In fact, that's what I did the first time, but I was pissed off by the last crash, and I replaced it with a wire. But anyway. Since the boards die from time to time, when I'm saying from time to time, it's really rare. When I build approximately something like 200 times a day when I run it for HAProxy, and maybe I find a dead board every 2-3 months, something like this. But it's still always annoying. So I used the heartbeat LED trigger to show what the device were doing. But in fact, the problem is that when they are idle, everything is just lit off, so you don't see anything. And it's very hard to tell the difference between a dead board and a board doing nothing. So I modified it and created a new LED trigger, which is called the LED activity. I think so, at least. And this one constantly emits some flashes, some very short flashes, and the duration of the flash increases as the load increases, and it constantly flashes. It's something between 1 and maybe 90% or something like this. So you can tell the difference between a hung board and a live one, and you can visually check that all your boards are being used. For example, I can already know when the kernel is linking at the end because they are not flashing anymore. That's quite convenient. So I submitted the patch a few times late because I'm not following merge windows that much. You know that usually I'm on the other side. I'm not really on the edge. And finally, the new trigger was accepted for the next 4.15. So in the end, in the office, with only 4 boards, I can reduce the build time to 3 seconds instead of 11 seconds for HAProxy compared to my laptop. I found that 11 seconds is not long, but in fact, you start to count. But at 3 seconds, you don't count. You just run a make-g, you run it, and it's done. So you don't have the time to switch to your mails, for example. It does not save that much of a time. At the end of the day, it's maybe less than half an hour. It does not count. I spend much more time chatting with coworkers. So it does not save much. But in fact, it really saves me from being tempted to do something else. However, still at the office, I can build a batch of two releases of our appliances during the lunch hour, so it's around 15 kernels. I'm not exactly sure, maybe between 13 and 15, I don't remember exactly. But I just run the script to make them all. We go to have lunch, and once we are back, many hours later, anyway, it's finished. That's quite convenient. And Atom, it's convenient as well during the 3.10 backport sessions because nothing works basically when I apply patches. In fact, I'm always happy when I see that patches apply well, but in practice that doesn't build. So it saves a lot of time on the weekend. I would say a few hours. What else to say? I send the feedback regarding the hardware design to the vendor, which is really cool. So they considered some of the shortcomings. They said they will address them in the future. Apparently, they don't want to use micro USB power anymore. There were some small issues, like some M3 holes, which were not as large as they should be, and to screw plastic spacers in them, you completely damage the thread on the spacers, stuff like this. The patches were sent to DCC. So as I said, you should basically never believe what USB power supplies advertise. On average, you count on half of it, and that's fine. The problem is that I needed a high power per port, and on this one, the ports had their individual limitations. So I managed to find a cheaper power supplies in which I was certain there was no limitation per port. So that's that. It addressed the problem. So a lot of work of build work remains local to the what I call the build controller, for example, my laptop. So you cannot imagine that you will build with an Atom or something like this. There are certain phases which are quite long, so you still need a reasonably performant machine. Here I have two cores at 3 GHz, 3.1 in fact. It's correct, it managed to keep four boards busy all the time, so that gives an indication. What else? I thought about trying to improve how the CPU is spent on the boards, because since I installed HAProxy, it managed to limit the number of parallel processes. And these boards have very powerful CPUs, which can be further overclocked. In fact, they can run up to 2.2 GHz approximately. But the power supply on the board, the voltage regulator does not stand and it cuts off. And for this, I figured that one good option could be to have a variable frequency depending on the number of running cores. So that's something to contemplate, but I took a look, it seemed difficult, so it was already fine for me like this, and I did not make progress on this. And so what? Yes, in general, there's no reason for trying to optimize further. I mean, it's very likely possible to save maybe 10 to 20 more percent by complicating everything a lot. So in my opinion, it's not worth it. I'm considering trying other boards now. I have been looking on the next workshop, the 3399, which contains two A72 cores and four A53. The boards are very expensive, but you start to see some cheap TV boxes using this CPU. So I bought one. It runs on Android. So I'm trying to port Linux to it the dirty way I used to do for the previous boards. I tried the upboard, which uses an Atom. In fact, it's very good. It's not as powerful as the Mickey, but it's really good. And it dissipates a lot less heat. So in fact, if you need to build a lot of files, actually it's a good option. It's, I would say, twice as expensive for the same amount of power, but you don't need to have fans or whatever. I don't need a fan on my farm. There is still one because in hot summer, I notice that they start to eat a little bit. So it's triggered by a thermal limit. It's just a script that I wrote. It checks the temperature and starts the fan. That's very simple. I also considered the latest Odroid board. It's not released yet. They built a cluster with powerful CPUs, apparently. You have four A15 and four A7. Initially, I was not interested, and I figured that they're running at 2 GHz. That's quite nice compared to the A17. So maybe that should be contemplated, and possibly I could also use the CPUs by putting the network stack and DCC on the small cores and having the large ones, only GCC on the large one. It would require some small modifications to DCC, however. I dropped DCC's pump mode, it's too complicated for me. And the same, I tried ICC. It's too complicated as well for me. In fact, I have a working setup. So once you have a working setup, there is no saving in trying to use something which sets up your environment for you. So its gains come from the fact that it's able to upload the toolchain to the remote board. But for me, it's already on them. So no saving. So that's all. Here are some links. I did not try them. I copy-pasted, but maybe some are wrong, but they are supposed to work, and that's all. So if you have some quick questions. Yeah. Microphone, please.
Do you also use C-cache?
No, I don't use C-cache anymore. I used to a long time ago, and I just stopped due to a slow disk and a slow file system many years ago. And since I dropped the habit to use it, I never think about it anymore. And I know it's supposed to work well combined with DCC. Nothing else? So thank you.